Okay.
So, how you guys doing? My name is Mike. Last name is File. I'm from Delaware. Grew up in Delaware. Graduated high school and then just came here to Lee for my 4.5 years here at Lee. I was a sociology major here. Graduated and moved back home, kind of settled back home to Delaware. And that's where my first job out of college was at Delaware School for the Deaf. So even though I kind of majored in sociology, I kind of made my kind of own major. I was a sociology major, but I kind of specialized in deaf studies kind of myself. I kind of made my own way. Because every presentation, every paper, it was really about deaf culture, the deaf community, kind of. Dr. Dirksen, if you guys had him at all, he was my professor, you know, all those years ago, and you know, we discussed it, and he was fine with that. So my first job out of college was at Delaware School for Deaf. That's where I met my wife, was staff there. She's deaf as well, so. And she comes from a deaf family. Her parents are deaf. Her brother and sister are deaf. She has cousins and uncles that are deaf. So big deaf family. So we started dating. Got married. We've been married for 22 years now. I have four daughters. Hope, who's 19. Morgan, who is 17.
There you go.
Callie is 15. And
oh, you got her age right too.
My youngest is 10. What's that?
You got Callie's age right.
Yeah, I did finally. Yeah. Well, I got four girls. Sometimes I forget their names and change their names and change their ages. So.
Oh, yeah. I'm Callie sometimes.
You understand that, Robin, right? let's see. My three of my daughters come from myself, obviously, and my wife, Christina. Hope is now. She's my daughter, just started on September 15th. So she is the newest member of our family, even though she's the oldest member of
the
family.
Baby.
Yeah. So I'm going to let her come up and kind of share her testimony, her story, because it's a very powerful one. So.
Hi,
there you go.
Hi, my name is Hope File. And I will be sharing my testimony. I'm originally a born from Astana, Kazakhstan. Kazakhstan is under Russia, next to China, and then all the other stands on the bottom. I lost both my birth parents as a baby, and then I got sent to live in an orphanage. I lived in the orphanage for about 6 years. But in the meantime, in the orphanage, it was a great time living there. I got treated like a princess. I could stay up later than the other kids. I got extra food. I got more playtime. I was very special to them. And it was just me. And I was very, very lucky for that. After the orphanage, getting looked at by other families to adopt. But I had a lot of families come and see me because they wanted to adopt. But the orphanage had said no to a lot of families. They wanted to find me a perfect family. On November 27, 2006, they did. They thought they found a perfect family. I would be getting two brothers. My youngest brother was also adopted from Kazakhstan, and he was adopted a couple months before I came into the new family. And then the middle brother, he was from the original parents. Within a couple months, I came here to America. And I started living my life here in Delaware. It was a struggle. I had to learn English, which took a long, long time. My speech was messy, so surgery to see if it would be less damaged because I had a harder time walking. I would always used to drag my right foot. So, in the meantime, before surgery, I got introduced to being a Catholic. They were Catholic. And I used to go to church every Sunday. And it was new to me. I didn't really get it. I took classes. It was a CCD class, which was just studying the Bible, learning about God, Jesus, and then I got told to pray whenever you worry, pray for anyone that was sick, just pray pretty much on about everything. You can talk to God, I got told. And I didn't really understand it or really care at that point, because it was just it was so new to me and I was getting used to other things. So I just was like, okay, yeah, sure. But going back to the surgery is coming up. I begged my new family not to let me have the surgery. I was so scared. I didn't think I would be making it alive after the surgery. I just heard stories from other people having surgeries. And I was just scared. I knew it was going to be a painful recovery. And I ended up having the surgery when the day came. And it was about a 7-hour procedure. I remember after the surgery, I had this huge cast on me. And then, I don't know what you call it, but it was like a big blanket, but it like rolled over. It was like to help me secure my right leg. And I couldn't move it at least for a couple of weeks because I had to wait until my stitches healed up because I had stitches from above my knee, the back of my leg, and then my foot. I ended up getting a 5-inch screw in my right foot, so I wouldn't be dragging it and bending it like this so it could be straight again. I had to take, of course, physical therapy, which was a progress, a very, very long progress. I think I ended up leaving the hospital I think it was 4 months. I ended up getting really sick in the hospital. I got pneumonia, and it took forever for me to recover. And also I was trying to move so I could start learning how to walk again. So I had to use this walker because in the meantime I was in second grade and I already missed school from November to March. And I had to do my homework, finish up whatever I missed so I wouldn't get held back because I was already older than the other kids because I came to the United States when I was 6. And usually when you go into kindergarten, you're like 5 and 6. And I was turning 7 when I entered school, when I learned enough basic English words. After surgery, I started getting abused physically and emotionally from my own family, both parents. My brothers weren't really getting it. They were getting treated like princesses, but it was just me. So I knew that's not how a family was supposed to be. And that's when I felt like I needed to start maybe connecting with God more. So I prayed for me to get healed, to maybe change something in the family. I thought maybe it was because they were tired of taking care of me because I was in a wheelchair at the time. I don't know. It wasn't really, I don't think it was just because I was in a wheelchair. It just ended up getting worse and worse. told one of my best friends that I first met here in America, and she was having a similar problem with her, both her parents, but it wasn't as bad as what I was getting. And I remember when we were talking and we were trying to come up with a plan. So I ended up going back to church once I was healed up more. And I remember, because I was a Catholic, so my priest came up to me one day and asked me, hey, so how was your surgery? How was your recovery? What's going on with you? And stuff like that. And I told him that there's been a lot of changes, and I just felt kind of left out, and maybe it was because of the surgery. He just told me to keep praying. So that's exactly what I did. I went to God. It ended up getting, over the years, it just got, they got stronger with the physical and emotional piece of it. In high school, I think that was the worst, because I went to a brand new school, thinking I could start over. I had a lot of friends. They were my family to me. I felt more love than the people I came home to. And I had met one of my friends in sophomore year. I skipped my lunch to go talk to her. And we weren't like friends. We were new to each other. We met through from other friends. And once I told her my story, I poured out crying, she poured out crying. And the first thing she said to me was, "You have to keep God in your life." And I took him out. I didn't really believe in God. I said, well, I don't know how I'm supposed to bring him back in my life when he's not changing my life and he's not hearing me. And I asked God, why is this happening to me? You know, I lost both my birth parents. I thought once I got adopted that this was going to be my perfect family. I thought this is how my life's supposed to be. It's going to go easy now because I already had my battles. And she was like, he might have a better plan for you in the very near future. You just have to keep praying about it. He'll change it. And I was like, well, okay, well maybe, we'll see. And so I slowly started regaining my trust with God again. And that's where I ended up meeting Morgan, who's my sister now. And we met through lifeguarding at a swim club in the summer. And we got closer as we had more shifts together. And I told her my story. And I found that she was also Christian. So it was another thing that it was to pray about. Like, I knew maybe God is helping me, and that's why he's already letting me go to my friends who believe in God and telling me to just keep praying and praying about it. And once I told Morgan, I knew she had told both her parents, and she told me just to come to her, text her whenever things got really, really bad. So the summer of 2019, I was 19. I came back from a trip from Europe with some of my Girl Scout friends. Both my both my parents were leaving a week after to go to Europe with my younger brother. Actually, they were going back to Kazakhstan to go check out the orphanage, and I had a choice to come, but I felt like that maybe I could start changing my life because I was 18 at the time. So maybe this is my getaway. Maybe I can change something. And while they were in Europe, I talked to Morgan. I told her how bad things next day, if they come home and things get much worse, because it was at the point where I was, I wanted to end my life. I tried committing suicide 7 times, and it was unsuccessful, but on the other hand, it was very successful throughout the years later. And I said, I'm gonna do whatever it takes to end my life if something doesn't change before they get home. So Morgan talked to her parents, opened the doors for me. She's like, we can pack up your stuff and we'll get you out of there, because I was an adult, so I could do whatever I want at that point. So it was in the middle of the night, the day before they came home. It was 1 o'clock in the morning. I picked her up. Went back to my house. I grabbed my files. She got my clothes, whatever else in my room I needed. And that was the last time I saw the house. Of course, it was bad for the next couple of days, because they came home to a note saying that I wouldn't be coming back. I'll be living with friends. And it was hard for the last couple of days because they were trying to figure out how they could take me back. But I had the right at that time to say no. I'll be living with friends. I'll figure something out. And yeah. So I soon realized that God was working in my plans. That I could maybe trust him again. And have him back in my life. And I started praying every night, because at that point I went to a friend's house living for a couple of weeks trying to figure out, what am I gonna do? And I was planning to only live there for about
two weeks
and leave, go find somewhere else. And I didn't care at the time if I was going to be homeless, because I was happy again to just leave that house. I have felt so happy and be able to breathe again ever since I started living with them again. They were in Florida, and I was trying to figure out the plan, but I was also starting soon my senior year of high school. And when they came back, I was telling them, hey, I'm gonna start packing my bags soon. I'll figure out something. Maybe I can live with one of my friends, because I had 2 other friends open the doors for me and live with them for the senior year. And then I could figure out a plan if I was going to college, or if I was just going to go work right away so I could save up some money for myself. And they were like, no, you can stay here. And I thought maybe like stay here and finish my senior year strong, because all my other years were not. They said, you can stay here whenever you are ready to be on your own feet again. That's what happened. And I started going to church with them. I knew they as Catholic and Christian. I thought they were the exact same thing. Morgan always told me, no, it's not. But when I first went to church that Sunday, I was like, no, it's not. It's definitely not. And I'm glad it wasn't, because I felt really connected with God. I was like, wow, I love this. And Catholic, not to be rude or anything, I kind of felt sleepy sometimes when the priest talked. And maybe we would all sleep a little. But this was more, I could pay attention. I felt like I could start connecting more with God, see where he's leading me to my future. And I felt nervous about it at first, because I knew I was a newborn Christian. I didn't know much. I didn't want to say the wrong thing. I didn't want to offend anyone. But it's been the best thing, becoming a Christian. And I said to Dad a couple of nights ago, going to youth ministries and not only study it and share my testimony and but help with other people who struggle connecting with God or maybe lost his trust, to help regain his trust, because it's the best thing you can do. And on last month, Dad said that, I already told you guys, I got adopted September 15th. Mm-hmm. And I have three younger, beautiful sisters. Even though sometimes I say, when I talk to people, that Maureen's the oldest. I always say that. I said to my friends that Maureen's the oldest, but no, she's not. I mean, she acts more.
I'm taller.
Yeah, she's tall. I am almost the smallest. My younger sister is gaining on me. But I have three beautiful sisters, and then I have the best parents, supportive parents, and I've learned so much what a family is supposed to be like within a year, and I should have been learning that within 12 years of my life when I first came here to America with my new family. But I learned a lot, and I'm ready to take it. I learned to help me grow in the future and share my story more and more, and share how God has helped me to the rest of the world. And I did write something because I will forget. I'm not that simple. So I said, I know I'm a newborn Christian and I still have a lot to learn, but I was praying before I went to bed a couple weeks ago, and I felt like the Lord was telling me that I have a voice that God wants me to use, and not only share my testimony, but help others who are having trouble connecting with God and want to have a stronger relationship with Him. I felt like I'm being called to go into the youth ministries. Now, again, I know I am new, and I'm young, but I'm willing to fight because it means I get to help others who are struggling to have a connection to God like I was. I need people to understand that nothing can stand against our God. Whatever you're facing in life, you will just hold your peace and remain at rest. God promises He will fight your battles. He will make a way even when you don't see a way. I know all of your days have been written in God's book, but when you go through a disappointment, do not stop on that page. You push yourself to stay on that course. You have to keep believing. I know you may be tired, discouraged, or even frustrated, but you do not give up on your future. Our God is faithful. He did not create you for you to give up on your life. He gave you that battle to fight because He knew you could handle it. Remember, God doesn't want you to try harder. Doesn't want you to try harder. He wants you to trust Him deeper. Stop trying and start trusting. This will change everything in you. Just keep holding on, stay strong, have faith, trust God, keep believing, and never lose hope. Nothing gets better than having a relationship.